Mustafa Haddad. He will answer the question, should the lower rectum ask for divorce?
It's really my pleasure to be with you here today, and I would like to thank Dr. Hisham Al-Ghazali specifically for inviting me for this talk. I think the first lecture, I think it made my way a little bit easy, but my lecture is not just a lecture that I'm going to speak about rectal cancer, or I'm going to discuss the details of the data that we have. My presentation will be something like a brainstorming or an idea that I'm thinking about long time ago. And the idea, simple way, says that the lower rectum is totally different than the upper rectum. And if we are treating the lower rectum in a different way, this may improve things, or we may have better results for our treatment. So the idea came to me that the lower rectum will go to the International Family Court and ask the international committee to be separated and to be divorced from the upper rectum. And this may be right and may be wrong, I really don't know, but let's imagine that we are in the court now and the chairpersons will be the jury, will be the judge, and you will be the jury, and I will be the lawyer for the lower rectum. Or maybe I would present the lower rectum itself and trying to justify why I want to be divorced from the upper rectum. First of all, let me introduce myself. I am part of the rectum. And if you ask me,
the rectum. You are part of the rectum, and this is the rectum.
It happens like this. If you ask me what does it mean, the rectum, you'll tell me that it's the straight part of the GI. But actually, I'm not straight. Because in mammals, yes, I'm straight. But here in human, I am not straight. We all know that I am following the sacral promontory, I'm following the sacral concavity, and I have some valves, or I have some mucosal folds that make me really not straight. But this is not the issue that my name is wrong. The problem that I want to be separated from the upper rectum. And why I want to be separated, let me tell you something very simple. Embryologically, it seems we are different. We all know that by the 4th or 7th weeks, there is something called the cloaca, and the cloaca will expand. And by the 7th weeks, the uroseptal diaphragm will divide it, and I will find myself, just without knowing how, be part of the hind gut, so the lower part of the anal canal, as well as the lower rectum, actually arising from the cloaca and not from the hind gut. But this may be debatable, because the lower part of the rectum, some consider it inside the anal canal. We all know something called anatomical anal canal as well as the surgical anal canal. Some consider the anal canal as the last 2 cm and others considered it the last 4 cm. So there may be a debate here. The second point, that we may be different anatomically. There is a slide missed here. Anatomically, we are different in a simple way. If you looked at the blood supply for the upper rectum and the lower rectum, you will find that the lower rectum can give you, in a simple way, lung metastasis without passing to the portal circulation, without giving you liver metastasis. Something that may not happen in the upper rectum simply because it is drained by the superior rectal vessels going to the inferior mesenteric and then go to the portal circulation. The lower rectum may be of worse prognosis. And maybe with this action of sending lung metastasis, maybe worse. Functionally, we are different. The upper part of the rectum is considered by mainly by or acting as a reservoir, but the lower rectum considered mainly by the sphincteric function. I'm strong enough to spare you or to keep you continent. And this is a very critical point, and I think many surgeons will stop me here. It seems we are different surgically. In a very nice review coming from Canada, they just sent a survey for the surgeon and asked them, how would you define the rectum? And the answer was very strange. Some consider the rectum starting at the rectosigmoid junction, and others they consider it as a number, starting from the anal verge 15 to 20 cm, and that's it. Others taking the peritoneal reflection as a landmark. Others consider the sacral S3 or sacral level S3 as the start of the rectum. So the definition of the rectum itself till now still debatable, even between the surgeons themselves. If you ask the surgeon where exactly the rectum will end, some will consider it end at the dentate line, it end above the dentate line, it end at the sphincter, the external anal sphincter, and that's why the definition of the anal canal we have problem till now. A very important point, the definition of the peritoneal reflection. And this is very important and critical for me as a radiation oncologist, because if the surgeon told me that this is not a rectum, this is a rectosigmoid, and the lesion is above the peritoneal reflection, I may consider not to give pelvic radiotherapy, because then the lymphatic drainage will be the same as that of the sigmoid colon. And the most critical point we just discussed a few minutes ago about the mesorectum. The mesorectum surrounding me is very narrow. In the upper rectum, the mesorectum is wide enough to make the surgeon happy to make an operation in the upper rectum and not in the lower rectum. If you ask any surgeon and ask him, would you prefer to do a surgery in the upper rectum or the lower rectum, he'll tell you, definitely, the upper rectum is much easier for me because the circumferential margin is easy to dissect and it's easy to get a negative circumferential margin than the lower part of the rectum. And this gives me the bad image of being bad. If you looked at the local recurrence of the local rectum, the pattern of recurrence of the local rectum is almost doubled to that of the upper rectum. If you're talking about 10 to 15% in the lower rectum, it's something like 2 to 5% in the upper rectum. It's something related to my sight. It's something related to my anatomy. That's why I'm different. That's why I want to be divorced from the upper rectum. And the most important point here that nobody is caring about my sphincter. Nobody is caring whether or not I'm continent. When you started to improve your results of treatment, and before going to the results, look at this Cochrane meta-analysis. Very interesting Cochrane meta-analysis. They tried to see whether the patient with colostomy live better or worse than patients with sphincteric preserving operation. And they couldn't dare or conclude, because we don't have this data yet, they couldn't conclude that patient with colostomy bag do worse. He had bad quality of life. We don't have the evidence. Imagine this. Imagine that a meta-analysis didn't say that patient with colostomy do worse or he is dealing a bad quality of life. You know why? I'll tell you why. Because simply, patient with colostomy abroad usually take better care. They do care about their patient more, but they didn't come here in our countries. They didn't come in the low social economic status that we have. It's very difficult for our patient to have or even to provide the bag for the colostomy. And if you ask anyone, do you live with colostomy, he would prefer to die without having this bag. If you ask our patient something very critical, that it's even very bad for their emotions and it's very bad for their work, for their religion point of aspect of view, because as a Muslim, as a Muslims, we consider this soiling is not good during our prayer. So this is not considered in the meta-analysis, and that's why it may not be positive. But believe me, if you did the same results or the same studies here in Egypt or in the surrounding region, you will find that this results is definitely positive. And we start, when you started to improve your results by adding adjuvant radiotherapy or adjuvant chemotherapy, you did succeed. You did succeed in improving your disease-free survival or improving your local tumor control. But look at me. Look at my colostomy bag. 40 or 50% of the patient in most of the clinical trial in the adjuvant setting had an APR resection. Nobody was looking for me. Nobody was looking for my sphincter. And when it comes to the preoperative era, I was a little bit happy because there was something that tell you that you have to wait, wait a little bit. Don't go for surgery up front. And the Swedish trial will tell you that there is a better local control and survival. And unfortunately, this trial is bad for the surgery. There was no TME excision, so we cannot rely on it, even if there is an overall survival advantage. So the Dutch group came and they did a TME excision with a preoperative radiotherapy short course, 5x5, you all know about it, with a TME excision, and again the radiotherapy improved local tumor control. But about the sphincter, it still there is a problem. However, with the update of this trial after 12 years, with something, there is something very nice inside that you have to look at it, you find that there was something there was mild improvement in the type of the operation or the skills of the operation. Because if 40% of the patient had tumor between 5 and 10, there was 28% only had an APR resection. So the APR resection started to decline by that time. Maybe it's not related to the radiotherapy. And this is very important because there is no time for the tumor to shrink with radiotherapy. It's just related to the surgical approach and the technique become a little bit better. There was something very bad I have to say before going there, that the results of the Swedish trial and the Dutch trial, even in patients with sphincteric preservation, you will never believe the incidence of fecal incontinence, even after sphincteric preservation operation, it was 60 to 65%. And if you looked why, you will see that the technique of radiotherapy was very bad. They used a huge field with an anterior posterior technique, so the late toxicity effect was unacceptable. And this is, will never be repeated as it was before. Something very nice happened in the last 5 or 10 years, the use of the protracted course, preoperative concurrent chemo radiation, and here comes the URTC trials. And the URTC trial told us something very interesting, and here there was some changing will happen in my life as a lower rectum. There was something new happening here. There was 13% pathological remission with the use of the long course concurrent chemo radiation with a simple chemotherapy, 5-FU-leucovorin. Something new is happening, and something new we started to know about. Maybe I have to mention here that the concurrent chemo radiation was successful even if, although the surgery was not that good. Something like 46% of the patients, we didn't know exactly whether they had a TME excision or not. When we compared the preoperative concurrent chemo radiation or the postoperative concurrent chemo radiation using with the German data, you find something very, very interesting. And please concentrate here because this is a very important point for all surgeons and all my colleagues. Look at the data of the patients only treated by abdominoperineal resection. Whether in the preoperative arm or the postoperative arm, treated by APR resection. Local recurrence rate was almost halved by using the preoperative concurrent chemo radiation. So as a surgeon or as an oncologist, if you decided for this patient to have an abdominal perineal resection, please give him preoperative concurrent chemo radiation because the results of local tumor control is much better. This is one. And the patient may be lucky enough to have a downstaging and may be lucky enough to enter in pathological CR. Yes, it's 13%, but who knows? Maybe he's lucky. And then you may spare his sphincter. With the ACCORD trial, as we go on, as the technique of radiotherapy and chemotherapy improving, as the chemotherapy we are using becomes stronger in the ACCORD trials, they added the oxaliplatin to the 5-FU, we had a 19% pathological CR. So we are rising up. Yes, on the expenses of toxicity. There is no doubt about it. Toxicity will be a problem till we will find out a solution. But the rate of conservative surgery in such a trial, although the number of patients was low, it was something like 75%, which is a new. Now, this number is really new. In the German trial using oxaliplatin, there was something again and again more and more interesting. 19% pathological CR, this is not a big deal. But look at the major regression, this is 25%. If I tell you that you may have something to do for those patients with microscopic residual disease, just go for local resection and you may spare their sphincter still. So there may be a chance for a patient something like between 40 to 45% still to have something to do for them and spare their sphincter. Professor Girard is my professor, I have to say that, and he did a very nice review about the value of the preoperative concurrent chemoradiation. And strange enough, he concluded that concurrent chemoradiation didn't add to the sphincteric preservation operations. But this is based on the data that we have. Imagine that I excluded the upper rectum from all clinical trials, and I started to look at the lower rectum as a separate disease entity. I started to look at the lower rectum as a separate organ, and we have hundreds of trials. I think the results will be much different. But do we have something to encourage us to do better for our patients? The data of San Paolo is there and tell us something very interesting. They showed us that some patients, when entered in pathological remission and went without going for surgery, they lived longer. So we know now, and we have a long-term data that told us that patients in complete pathological remission will live longer. And the more you will push your patient to pathological remission, there may be a chance for your patient to survive long. And this, I think, is proved now with this wonderful cell survival curve. As you can see, the complete line for patients with complete pathological remission. There's a lot of data about it, not going through it, but I'm sure that we can do better for our patient, but just give me my freedom. Just accept the divorce of the lower rectum from the upper rectum. What we can do together is a lot. First, we can challenge the 2 cm margin. We are now challenging the 1 cm resection margin, and even we are challenging now 1 millimeter resection margin cutting through the tumor just below the disease or the remaining disease after the concurrent chemoradiation, and I think the data is emerging there. Maybe the surgeon will accept, or maybe we have to discuss this more. You can add more dose to radiotherapy. Most of the clinical trials, they use 45 gray, 50 gray, and that's it. So what about if I push the dose more? And there is a lot of methods of pushing the dose more. You can use a superficial, old-fashioned Papillon technique or Jean-Pierre Girard, and we have data now telling us that if you push the dose more, more patients will enter in pathological remission and more patients, you may spare more sphincters for your patients. There's ongoing trials, a lot of ongoing trials using this Papillon 50 is a new machine. This is a renovation of the old one machine. I think there is a three at least randomized trials going now using this machine, trying to boost the tumor dose more, aiming for sparing the sphincter for our patients. You can use also the high dose brachytherapy, inserting the needles or inserting a balloon inside the rectum and push the dose more. Some people are working now for trying to search for a blood biomarkers for that response. If you find this biomarker and you find that those patients are responders, you may wait for them. You may go for radical concurrent chemo radiation and avoid the surgery. Some researchers just evaluated the patient at day 7 concurrent chemo radiation. If he's responding, he should continue. If not responding, he can go for concurrent chemo radiation. I'm waiting for the day where the end point for the lower rectum or the lower part of the rectum to be not the disease-free survival and not the overall survival, but to be the colostomy-free survival, the same as we did in the anal canal squamous cell carcinoma. There was a long time that we had and went along to separate the colon from the rectum, so I'm not in a hurry to separate the upper rectum from the lower rectum. And finally, I'm just suggesting or just a proposal for the lower part of the rectum to be called the surgical rectum, and the whole rectum you can consider it as the anatomical rectum. And first, we have to get divorced. The first, I need a new staging system for the preoperative and the postoperative. I need to push the dose more. We don't stop at 50, we'll push to 60. The CRM should be integrated inside the staging system. You cannot wait and put it aside as it is now. You have to integrate it inside, and this is suggesting 2A without and 2B with positive CRM positive. Pathological remission should be integrated inside the staging system, and if the patient went into near total CR, still you can do for them better by local excision, and this will need more and more clinical trials. IMRT should be the standard of care, similar to that of the anal canal, and finally assess the response after 8 weeks. Don't wait, I won't go for surgery very, very early. So as a jury, you have to decide, and as a chairperson or a judges, you have to decide whether or not it's time for divorce. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Mustafa, for your very, very interesting lecture. I'm satisfied by what you said, and I think برغم المصريين بيقولوا الصلح خير، لا هنا الديفورس هيبقى أحسن كتير يعني. Any question?
Thank you, Dr. Mustafa, for your very elegant presentation, but you must talk about the functional results after sphincter-saving procedures, particularly after neoadjuvant chemotherapy. This is very important, not only to save the sphincters and to do a very low anastomosis, what we call ultra-low anastomosis, or coloanal anastomosis. The functional results with incontinence is very common in this situation. And in some situations, we go back to have a colostomy for better functional results. So it's just not just only to preserve the sphincter. We must preserve a functional sphincter. Number one, increasing the radiotherapy dose after 60 gray will worsen this condition even more, and you will get more incontinent patients that you will go back for colostomy. Thank you.
Thank you very much. It's a very, very interesting comment, because this is a very, very important point. When you looked at the data of the Swedish and the Dutch group, the functional outcome was 60% fecal incontinence in patient with sphincteric preservation operation. This number decreased markedly. If you looked at the URC trial, this figure came out to be 9%. And I really do trust in the surgeons. I do trust that the surgeons can do better in the sphincter preservation operation. It's similar to any other operations. If we think or we looked at the data in old series of surgical series, I think it was much, much worse than we have now. Concerning the high dose, if I'm looking to the situation as if I'm treating my patient radically, I am not looking that you will go again and try to do a sphincteric preservation operation. I'm treating my patient radically. He will live as long as he can, similar way to that of the anal canal. With the anal canal, we go for radical treatment. We are not aiming for something else. I want to, for the patient to be cured, to live long without a colostomy bag, and if relapse, go for APR resection. So that's it. And what I'm looking for is treating the lower rectum same as that of the anal canal. And that's what we are doing. With the anal canal patients, we are treating them in a radical way. If went in CR, we leave them. That's it. And if relapse, we go for APR resection. So if patient relapse in lower rectal tumor, go for APR resection, no problem.
Don't have any surgery for complete pathological response. It's different. But now, if you have a sphincter denervation, number one, and you go for surgery with denervation and more injury, if you have, even if you are a very meticulous surgeon, we have some injury to the sphincters anyhow. And the percentage of 60% is an international figure now accepted for this type of treatment. And this is against neoadjuvant chemotherapy in these cases. Particularly in early cancer cases, we don't go for neoadjuvant chemotherapy anymore just to preserve the function, and we do a real sphincter preserving surgery at that time without any radiotherapy or chemotherapy.
So early stage disease, I'm just talking for T3-T4. I'm just talking about T3-T4 diseases. I'm not talking about the T1-T2. Because still he has still the option of sphincteric preservation with intersphincteric surgery or local tumor excision. So the T1, T2 disease is still, he still can have something, we can have something for him. But I'm talking about T3, T4 disease that, I mean, he needs to be controlled and then to live long as much as he can without a bag. That's it. My point of view is a bag. This is the point. I'll tell you the difference. We are talking about two different situations. One with patient treated by concurrent chemo radiation and then went for sphincteric preservation operation, yes? But I'm talking about patient will be treated by concurrent chemo radiation and that's it, without going for any other treatment. Whether or not it is enough, we need some more time, I mean, we need time to make it, I mean, safe. I'm not saying that this will be the standard of care. I'm not saying that patient will be cured with my treatment, with the radiotherapy, but I'm just saying that he can live in a better quality of life for a longer period of time.
I'd just like to add to what Professor Wahid said, is that a very important factor in incontinence following sphincter-saving preservations, sphincter-saving surgery, is that you resected the rectum. You remove the rectum, which is the reservoir, and you do a straight colo-anal anastomosis. The function of the colon, as you know from physiology, is that whenever a stool bolus arrives to the colon, it makes peristalsis and pushes it into the rectum. And the rectum is a reservoir, and we'll keep these newcomers and then until for 1 day or 2 days, and then we go to evacuation. So a very important factor is that you lose the rectal reservoir by rectal resection.
I don't want to do surgery. This is the point.
I just want to clarify my point. Yes, I'm with you that in order to preserve continence, it's not to do sphincter-saving preservations and to push surgeons to do more sphincter-saving preservations. Again, you will end with incontinence because you lost the rectal reservoir. But if you can achieve what has been achieved in the anal canal, by radiochemotherapy that, yes, abandoned surgery in 80% of patients. If you can achieve this, and this is not proved, although this is the aim. You mentioned some of the studies, but this is not the standard of care.
Yes.
But if we can achieve this,